was developing this option. I switch that in all the caps. Not much more to say in profits and not profit stuff as well. But that's not important at all. I'm here to talk about accepting software. I know it's not probably the most exciting topic, but in my eyes, from my experience that I've seen through the years, it's really a crucial part of the software development lifecycle. And it can do a lot of damage if you don't do it the proper way. So we're going to talk about what it is, the different types, where it's extremely important to have it, like areas of application. Part of the different types of life cycles, acceptance testing, challenges that you may face, some tips and hints how you can avoid big problems and big disasters. And because this is a region where we all do, well, most of us, many of us do outsourcing in Eastern Europe, you know, Ukraine, Belarus, Russia, Bulgaria, Romania, Poland. I'll say a couple of words about the acceptance testing and outsourcing center. So what is the acceptance testing? By definition, and I see there are a lot of fans of ISTQB here, this is the ISTQB definition of acceptance testing. We have three things that we respect to: the user needs, requirements, and business processes. And the objective of the acceptance testing is whether or not to determine whether or not the requirements or the acceptance criteria have been satisfied. And based on that, your end customer will decide whether to accept or to reject the system. So this is really a bit different than the other types of testing that people are used to, like unit testing, like system testing, integration testing, where the objectives are different. What are the objectives of the other types? Mike, in the previous presentation, Mike mentioned about the first definition of software testing being finding bugs. And actually, some of the, the definition is not exactly correct. And he added the second part, which is covered mainly by the acceptance testing. So in unit testing, system testing, you make sure you have found most of the defects, the serious defects, the most important problems in the system, and solve them before you go to acceptance testing. Yeah. But in the acceptance testing itself, that's not the target. The target is to make sure the system works according to the business requirements, according to the wish of the customer. Of course, you can find bugs, but that's not the objective of the acceptance. How many of you actually are doing acceptance testing or have acceptance testing teams involved in their departments? Well, okay, pretty good number of people. So, from that perspective, there's two important things. One is to make the software compliant to the business objective, and the other one is to expose if there is functionality that is required by the client, by the customer, but is not yet in the requirement. So, if during the acceptance testing, you can find gaps, more like a journey to the system. It's not only a technical system, as I said. Some organizations are doing also so-called production acceptance testing, because in some businesses, it's not only software. If it's a mobile app, that's okay, you can do it. It's just a piece of software, it works on its own. But I've been involved in the project, many projects, but this particular one was very interesting. Imagine an organization like IBM, for example. They want to distribute spare parts for their laptops everywhere in EMEA areas, Europe, Middle East, Africa. So they build this huge warehouse, 1.5 kilometers long, lots of trucks, and they start picking parts from shelves, going to conveyor belt, packing them in packs, putting a label, load the trucks, ship to airplanes. It's a huge, huge operation. It's not software. Software just monitors all these processes, but we have also manual operations involved, we have people involved. So what we did for the production acceptance testing, we hired 200 temporary workers. We trained them for 3 months, how they, pick stuff from shelves, how they use the conveyor belt, how they know how to drive tracks, but how they do this, all this operational stuff. And we did operational testing, production acceptance testing for 1 month. So we were actually picking parts, packing them, shipping them to a real address, and the user was there, and he was calling us, oh, I got my package to take on time, with the right label, and things like this. So, user acceptance test is a bit broader, topic. There might be variations depending on the system that you use. It can be a small piece of software, but it can be a really big organization. Operational acceptance testing. This is not so much about the software that we've developed. This is about the operational team that is going to maintain the system tomorrow in production. So we talk about non-functional testing. It's more accepting by this team that they're going to use the system on a daily basis. If they can do their work properly, so we talk about backup and response procedures. Disaster recovery. How many of you have been involved in disaster recovery stuff? Wow, okay. Right, so you know what I'm talking about. Also, user management, access, roles. How can they do that? Maintenance tasks, weekly maintenance, daily maintenance, monthly maintenance. The data log, migration, data migration, they have to be checked as well. And of course, security. That's out of question, everybody has to know. When we say contract and regulation acceptance testing, this is when, let's say, we have a client who orders some software piece to be developed by another company, like third party or outsourcing, and then you have a contract between these two companies. And in the contract it said that the custom software will be developed. And for this custom software, you have to have some acceptance criteria when the customer receives the software to make sure it's the software that he ordered. So then we talk about contract acceptance testing because it's between two different companies. Sometimes we have also regulation acceptance testing when it depends on government policies and procedures. Also safety regulations, like for example, gambling. Gambling is regulated. There is a big online poker provider all over the world, over 160 countries, but it's forbidden in Bulgaria, because it doesn't cover our local regulations of the government. Until they cover the local regulations, they will be accepted in, into the operation. Then we talk about the regulation acceptance testing. And alpha and beta testing, so much to say about this. Alpha is mainly done internally in the organization. more money for testing than for development, because they have to make not 100, but 300% sure there is no bugs in the system, and this shuttle is not going down, this plane is not going down. Same with healthcare. Imagine you're testing software for cardio surgery. You want to have bugs in this one? I don't think so. Of course, there are other areas like, you know, finances, insurance. Also, you don't want tomorrow, because of bad testing, to go to the bank and see that your bank account is empty. Yeah. Somebody stole your money. So, it is important in some areas more than others. Of course, embedded, you have a lot of software in the cars at the moment. Different systems, cars at the moment are like computers. Gaming and CRM system, that's also fine. So, you see, it's important. It's really crucial in some areas. Of course, if you're doing web development and you have a website of 10 pages, it's maybe not so important. So during the years, we think we're getting smarter. There should be more successful projects, less failures. But is it so? For the last 5 years, this is the chaos report. I don't know if you know this. It's an important document that is published every year. You see, it's not really going better. And the failures are also not getting less. So you can say agile, you can say whatever, new technology, but the truth is the percentage of successful projects is not going up. Why? Well, that's why. These are the reasons for failures of projects, according to this report, which two are the biggest ones: incomplete requirements and lack of user involvement. That's exactly what I'm talking about. Acceptance of software. Most of the projects fail because of lack of user involvement and bad requirements. Why is it going to happen, this disaster? Through my life, I've seen a number of challenges that are really repetitive. They happen every time. First of the thing is that, you know, the user is too busy. They don't work for you. They have other things to do. They have business to run. You know, they're not in your software development team. They're in different organizations. You're not the boss. So they don't have time. What do you do then? How do you solve this? You have to start as soon as possible. There is different stages of the process that user has to be involved, like creating the requirements and then creating the test cases, especially for acceptance testing. Because what I'm saying is that they have to create the test cases, not us. User have to create his own test case. And of course, executing it yet and reviewing the system and accepting or rejecting. Second challenge: motivation of the user. Why should I do this testing? You know, it's at the end of the project. Even if I find something that is not working, it's too late. Deadlines, I have to go live. So no motivation. It's it looks like formality at the end of the cycle. Well, how can you solve this? You say, do not let the users get too much involved in the team about deadlines and about the project problems. They have their own task. They have to accept the system. Let them focus on that and not worry about the other things. Another challenge. Yeah. I'm here. Tell me what to do. Well, that shows that these people that are coming to help you are probably not the right ones. Probably lack of understanding of the new system, probably lack of experience, not skilled enough. You really need a good business people that can understand the business process to tell you if this system is going to work or not. Otherwise, I don't think it's going to work. And also, again, it's a question of timing. Have them involved and have them prepared. Otherwise, it's not going to work. Users should be really motivated. And as I said, they have to write their own test cases based on their own process. As much as we know the business of the user, we are testers, we are software developers. You don't really learn this business, so you don't know 100%. They know 100%. And let them do this part. Let them write their own test cases and let them execute them and tell you if the system is good or not. Of course, they don't have enough knowledge about testing, and you can help them with the process of testing, but the actual business knowledge is on their side. And there are some other reasons to fail. I mean, I'm not going to list everything. Why? Because this outsourcing organization, let's say you are back and you outsource to one company in Russia. But this company is Russia, they may work with another five banks. So they have a different point of view. Maybe you're thinking, oh, guess what? They know much better than you because they've seen already other banks how you do it and they can make comparison and they can give you an advice how to do it better. Even if they don't find all the problems, they still can give you good advice. Also, I was talking about contractual testing. Imagine the bank and the company get involved in the discussions who is right and who is wrong. Sometimes it's better to have an independent party that is actually acceptance testing to avoid those kind of contractual discussions and going to a court, those kind of complications that nobody wants. If such a party is involved in advance, well in advance, preparing together with the customer the business requirements and the test cases afterwards, you can avoid a lot of problems, contractual, government, and stuff like that. And my last slide today, it's about certifications. You know, we talked about all about STTP, which is requirements engineering, usability, and all these really value add products. I just want to mention one organization that is a mobile provider of certifications in the area of IT. They have about even more than 30 certifications. It's called ISQI International Software Quality Institute. I'm mentioning them because he's the managing director of the company. Stefan Görges is there. Stefan, can you stand up, please? So people see you and maybe they will have questions after that for you. So they can help you with the different types of testing, building knowledge and proving that you have this knowledge. That was it. Good time, yeah. it's